Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Iron Gate, a 20 Palaces novel featuring the novella The Twisted Path by Harry Connolly. Narrated by Daniel Thomas May. The Twisted Path. After. I laid my clammy, sweating hand on the door lever and pushed. It was a good door, made of dark wood with a tight grain that suggested strength born of tough years. The door's recessed panels were like windows without panes, and the lever was the color of gold. Or maybe it was actual gold. I had no way to tell. Be casual. I stepped through and let the door swing shut on the leather chairs and plush carpeting of that room. The hall was as bleak and depressing as an old high school, but more cramped. The floor was bare concrete, pitted and stained by decades of neglect. The ceiling was coated with something that looked like it had been chewed by wasps. Along one wall were more doors, each as fancy as the one I'd just walked through. The other side held the sole source of light, large, clouded windows that let in the afternoon sun without letting anyone see in or out. I was inside the First Palace, headquarters of the 20 Palace Society, and I was in trouble. Standing midway down the hall, staring at the glass as though she had X-ray vision, was Annalise, my boss. One of the peers of the society, she'd brought me in under complicated circumstances, and she'd cast most of the spells currently tattooed onto my body. Whatever power they gave me, hers dwarfed it. She glanced at me as I approached, then turned back toward the window. A crack in the sill let in a shaft of daylight, and I stood beside her for a moment, watching sunlight shine into the room and swirling dust motes get sucked out. Boss, I said, we should get the fuck out of here. I'm pretty sure you have a predator inside the society. Before. There's a guy out there in the world with the same name as me, and he's a real asshole. He's broken into houses, burned down buildings, and killed people. He's killed a lot of people. Every time a cop runs my ID, the asshole's name pops up, and I end up looking down the barrel of a gun. Once everything gets straightened out, it's all, sorry, Mr. Lilly, but I'm sure you understand. And I do. I really do. The guy they confuse me with has done terrible shit. Then they look me over one more time. They look over my boss. They check out our tattoos, her ragged clothes, and the expressions on our faces. They have second thoughts. For a moment or two, anyway. Could it really be a mix-up? Finally, they shake their heads and walk away. So far, none of them have pulled the trigger. So far. But if one of those cops does finally put a bullet in my brain, I can't exactly say it'd be unfair. That asshole with my name who's done all those shitty things? That's me. My name is Raymond Lilly, and I'm on a twisted path. And according to Annalise, the next step on that path was to get on an international flight, somehow. But first, Annalise wanted to see Atlanta again, so Atlanta it was. I didn't mind. I liked driving, and the long hours spent riding from LA to the East Coast, not including the little job we did in Vegas, was my idea of relaxation. It was a chance to get my head straight. I needed it. Like I said, I've killed people. Some were friends. We parked her van in the garage of a little house on the outskirts of Macon, sometime before midnight. The place smelled as though the windows had been shuttered for months, but if it bothered Annalise, she didn't show it. We took turns showering. The back bedroom had a suitcase full of clothes in my size. Somebody in the society knew my inseam, which was creepy as hell. In the morning, we rode a Greyhound to Atlanta. My boss retrieved an envelope from a bus terminal locker, and we took a cab to the airport. The envelope contained a pair of passports. Annalise looked at me, looked at the cabbie, then looked at me again. I got the message. Take this and shut the fuck up. The birthday was the same as mine, but the address was local to Macon. I memorized it. The name was Raymond Rose. I hated it. It was worth 25 years of federal time to get busted with a fake passport, but the society's fake paper passed scrutiny. We flew to New York, then London, then Lisbon in the fading day. Apparently, the other peers of the 20 Palace Society wanted a look at me, and when they snapped their fingers, I hopped. From the air, Lisbon looked like a sprawl of orange roofs atop white walls, but from the ground, it looked like any other city at night, except for the fucking sidewalks. We spent the night in the Hotel Roma, which didn't look all that Roman, but what the hell. The bed was huge, but Annalise pointed me at the couch. At 5 foot nothing, she could have fit on the couch easily, but she was the boss and I was the one laying cushions on the floor. When I woke, I went onto the green-tiled balcony and looked at the city in the morning light. Fucking Europe, man. 2 years ago, I was an ex-con from L.A., a former runaway trying to put a life of stealing cars behind me. Even before I met Annalise, I was the sort of idiot who didn't expect to live to 30. I never thought of myself as a guy who would go to Europe. And maybe I hadn't. Raymond Rose was standing in a hotel in Portugal, not Ray Lilly. We left the hotel without breakfast. In the daylight, the city looked a little less like the cities I was used to. It was disorienting to see all the store and street signs in Portuguese. Every jumble of letters was like a lock I couldn't pick. I wondered if it had been like this for Fidel Robles's parents when they snuck into California on the back of a truck. Poor Robbie. I missed him. He'd tried to murder me, but I missed him. Annalise walked like she knew where she was going, so I tagged along. For once, I was glad she didn't expect me to drive. Not when every traffic sign was like a secret code. I had no idea where we were going, and not too long ago, that would have annoyed the shit out of me. Annalise wasn't the type to explain herself. I used to think it was because she hated me, and she did, once, but now I suspected it was because she'd spent so many years operating in secret that it would never occur to her to talk about her plans. Even something like, "Let's grab a sandwich at this place I like," would feel like a dangerous habit. After a little less than half an hour, we turned off the street and climbed a flight of worn stone steps. So many people had stepped in this same place that they had reshaped square-edged granite, or whatever these stairs were made of, into something that looked like melting butter. My boots were scraping a thin layer of molecules off the top, just like thousands of others before me. It made me feel small and temporary. And I guess that was the point.
"This is an English-language bookstore,"
Annalise said as we reached the top step and turned a corner.
"Which is a fine excuse for visitors from different countries to stay a long time."
Except the shop was closed. Maybe we should have walked slower. A smiling man pushed off from the wall and came toward us.
"You are here. I have been waiting. I waited yesterday too, but..."
"Fuck off,"
Annalise said.
"Please,"
he said, clasping his hands like a beggar.
"Just hear me out. This is a perfect job for you. Very dangerous people."
"How many times do I have to tell you?"
Annalise said.
"You know who to call."
"I have called."
He was distressed, but still smiling.
"I promise you."
Then he turned his attention to me. I turned up my palms. "Talk to my boss." He waved his hand as though clearing away a bad odor.
"Yes, yes, a wooden man, correct? I know who you are. Many people are learning your name."
I didn't like that, but I did like him. There was no reason for it, but I did. He was a few inches shorter than me and slender, with dark hair and a generically handsome face. His smile was broad and gave every appearance of being genuine. But there was a tiny black sigil at the corner of his left eye. I didn't know enough about magic to know what it did just by looking at it, but I could feel a slight pressure against the protective iron gate spell below my collarbone. Maybe it was some sort of charm spell, but if so, it was weak.
How do you like Lishbua so far?
He pronounced it Lishbua.
Have you toured the castle? Seen the tile work? What do you think?
Mixed signals, I answered. He seemed surprised, so I pointed down the length of the street. Take a look. It's a street. Curb, sidewalk, buildings. Like a wall of buildings 3 stories high that come right up to the edge of the sidewalk. No space in between them. No alleys behind. Just one huge thing that stretches from one end of the block to the other. The whole city looks like this so far. The shops, the apartment buildings, that one across the street that looks abandoned. It's everywhere. With graffiti. In some parts of the U.S., that's how poor people live. Boxy apartment buildings with shit spray painted on the side. Poor people. But then I look around. Everyone coming out of the front doors is dressed for office work. I nodded toward a man in a blue suit. Briefcases.
Yes,
he said.
I lived 2 years in Colorado. Americans like lawns and distance from each other. Quite different.
And these sidewalks. I looked down. Instead of the American idea of a sidewalk, smooth ribbons of cement with evenly spaced grooves, we were standing on little yellow diamond-shaped stones, all identical, with narrow gaps between them. The sidewalk didn't crack and buckle. It sagged and rolled like an ocean frozen in time. I hated it without any real idea why I should. This is everywhere, and it's clear this is part of the culture, right? Part of the history. It's probably expensive.
Calzada, it is called. In some places, it is like a mosaic. Very traditional and beautiful.
Where I come from, sidewalks are only uneven like this because of neglect. That, again, suggests this is a place for the poor, but again, it's not.
Mixed signals, it's true. Things are different here. But there are many beautiful... How about this? I will show you Lisboa. You and your peer both, perhaps. The beautiful old buildings, the shopping, the cruise ships. Americans like to see old places, don't they? Tiles, plazas, the castle, all of it. Ancient churches, great shopping. All I ask is that we talk about a predator.
He said the last word at a whisper.
That the society has overlooked. Take my card and text me. You will not regret it.
I accepted his card. The only thing on it that I could read was his number. He glanced at the black marks on the backs of my hands. They looked like random shapes, but in fact they were spells, like my iron gate and twisted path.
I will expect to hear from you,
the guy said as he retreated down the stairs.
Tomorrow, or tonight. Please, this is too important to miss.
At this point, the lights in the store switched on and a middle-aged woman moved about inside, but she didn't turn the lock on the door. I tried to peer in to see what was on the shelves. I'd bought a paperback in Hartsfield in Atlanta, and I needed a new one. Annalise was watching me.
Are you going to call him?
I don't know. What the fuck was he talking about? Shopping?
Tourists like to shop, Ray.
I'll take your word for it. The last time I took a trip for fun was years ago, before I went to prison for the first time. I'd gone for girls and drinks, not commemorative mugs or fridge magnets. But it sounds like he has a job for us. Annalise rolled her eyes. That guy's an ally, isn't he? The 20 Palace Society divided spellcasters into 3 categories. First, there were the rogues, people who cast dangerous magic, especially summoning magic. They were a threat to every living thing on Earth, down to the smallest flu germ. In other words, assholes. Then there were the peers of the society, like Annalise, who hunted them down. But even though the peers fought to protect all of us, you couldn't really call them good guys. Their job was killing, and they weren't super careful about it. That made them a better class of asshole, but still assholes. Finally, there were the allies, low-level spellcasters who abided by the society's rules and helped out on occasion, but who didn't have the power or temperament to be full peers. As long as they did as they were told, they were allowed to live. I'd never met an ally before, so it was too early to tell what grade asshole this guy was. Annalise glanced up at me, then checked to see who was near enough to hear.
Yeah, he's an ally. He's also a fucking pest. Are you going to meet him?
I can't read anything on this card except the number. I don't even know his name.
Let me see.
I handed it to her.
See this? This is his name.
The text she pointed to said, João Font Costa.
That first name is the Portuguese version of John. If you pronounce it João, you'll be close enough to flatter a guy like him.
The woman in the shop threw back the deadbolt and switched the sign to open. We filed in. The shopkeeper must have known my boss pretty well because she didn't make an effort to be pleasant. It was a small shop, which was not a surprise. I tried to move toward the mystery section to replace my airport book, but Annalise caught my elbow and led me toward a circular staircase. It led down. Annalise had black marks on her skin, too, lots of them, but they were more powerful than mine. I'd seen her tear car doors off their hinges. I'd seen bullets bounce off her skin. Her grip on my arm was like a steel handcuff, and I let myself be shoved toward the stairs. I had to do what I was told to. Annalise was a vigilante, but not the kind you find in comic books. She killed rogues and dealt with the predators they summoned. We met when she was hunting an old friend of mine. Some asshole had summoned up a predator and put it into him. I did everything I could to save my friend, but in the end, I had to help her put him down. Now she was my boss, and the two of us have been traveling the western U.S. chasing down bad magic. From what she told me, we'd been successful enough that people were starting to notice. Actually, what they'd noticed was me. As Annalise's assistant, her wooden man, I'm supposed to have the lifespan of a fruit fly. The peers of the society don't know how I could survive so many jobs, and I dragged my ass across the Atlantic so they could ask me in person. It was a long way to travel to meet a bunch of assholes I was pretty sure I'd hate. At the bottom of the circular stair was a comfortable little room with a cheap foam couch and a pressure board bookshelf. Annalise slid the shelf aside. There was a keypad on the wall. She looked at me. I turned my back while she entered the code. She may not have wanted to kill me anymore, but she still didn't trust me. I doubted she trusted anyone. She was smart like that. A latch released and hinges creaked. I turned and saw a stone tunnel with an arched roof. I followed her inside. She pulled the door shut. The air was damp and smelled musty as hell. The walls were slick with nasty-looking water, and I wouldn't have touched them for $100. Still, a secret passageway. This is fucking cool.
Ray, I want you to meet with the pest. Find out about this job he's supposed to have, and the predator, too. Assuming the peers don't murder you.
After. João wanted to meet the next morning in a cafe across the city. Since I wasn't planning to return to the first palace, I ate breakfast in the basement of the hotel, which was a buffet of industrial scrambled eggs, Vienna sausages, and 24 different kinds of baked good. Afterward, Annalise pressed a few colorful bills into my hands and told me she was keeping the hotel room, but that I wasn't to let anyone follow me there. She also told me to keep my fucking mouth shut about the society and the unhappy conversation we'd had yesterday in the hall. Finding the cafe was more difficult than I expected, even with João's directions. The street and place names looked like a jumble of random letters and wouldn't stay in my memory. Worse, I had no sense of the way the city was laid out. Luckily, random people were kind enough to help me buy a subway pass out of a machine, then they pointed me at the train I needed. I stood in the crowded rush-hour car, watching the names of the stations appearing on the digital display. I tried to guess how the automated announcer would pronounce them, but I was wrong every time. I was still 5 minutes early, although Annalise had warned me that for many Portuguese it was common to be late, sometimes very late, and he'd be insulted if I complained. Luckily, I'd bought a new crime novel on my way out of the first palace, and I never cared about insulting people. The seats outside were crowded and the day was bright. I sat inside against the wall near a freezer full of soft drinks. I looked them over. Not only were the labels in another language, the shapes of the bottles were new to me. I figured the freezer would cool me down every time someone opened it, and I was right. The waitress approached. I looked down at the text Joao had sent me and read, as best I could, the words there. Bom dia. Queria café, faz favor. When I looked up at her again, her lips were pressed tightly together. That was my first attempt, I said.
Before you try this,
she added, gesturing toward my phone,
you should say, fala inglês. It means, do you speak English?
Fala inglês? I repeated, copying her the best I could.
I do,
she said pleasantly. I ordered a coffee, and she brought me the tiniest cup of coffee I'd ever seen in my life. It was barely larger than a shot glass. Annalise was right, as she often is. Joao didn't show at 9 a.m. as planned, and he didn't show 15 minutes late. Or 20 minutes. I ordered another mini coffee and read my book. Our meeting was too important to miss, wasn't it? So was the guy late because something happened to him or because he was showing me disrespect? I didn't like to think about it. Annalise had called him a pest, but I sorta hoped it was disrespect. If he'd found out something important and gotten himself eaten, well, cops would start poking around and Annalise might want to burn down his house just in case he kept a spellbook there. Then we'd have to dig up his friends and family so we could track down whatever it was that he was worried about. In all, a lot of extra work for me. My phone buzzed. There was a text from Joao that read, "My friends are there." I had no idea what that was supposed to mean. A cell phone two tables over rang like an old-fashioned corded line, the noise sharp and annoying. The man who answered it was just under 40, with a broad nose, thinning hair, and the complexion of a California surfer. He heard something alarming over the phone and jolted ramrod straight in his chair. Then he glanced nervously around the room. He stopped looking when he saw me. For a moment, he just stared. I had no idea what was going through his head, but he had obviously recognized me, and he was not pleased. The only problem was that no one knew I was here except the people in the 20 Palace Society. This was Portugal, for fuck's sake, a place I couldn't point to on a map. Unless this dude singled me out because I was the only guy in the place without product in his hair, this had to be Joao's friend. I stood. My new buddy didn't like that. He caught the waitress and spoke to her in a low voice. I dropped a 10 the color of spilled wine on the table. My new buddy looked like he was about to run, and we hadn't even been introduced. Hey, are you the friend Joao told me about? It was only after I heard myself say the name that I remembered I was in a foreign country. The waitress had told me how to ask if someone spoke English, but I suddenly couldn't remember it. Joao? My buddy glanced at me in recognition, then looked away. Maybe I wasn't saying it right. Maybe he knew 10 guys with that name. The waitress's words came back to me as I said them. Fala inglês, man. He twitched, but he wouldn't look me in the eye. I wanted to snatch the phone out of his hand to see who had called him, but somebody would probably call the cops. Buddy pivoted and pushed through a fire door right beside his table. I'd picked a seat because it would be comfortable, but he'd picked one with an easy retreat close by. I still had a lot to learn. I shouted,
"Yo!"
Everyone looked at me, but the only one who mattered was Buddy. I snapped his picture with my phone. He rushed into the alley. Before I could follow, my waitress barred my way.
"I'm sorry," she said, "but you must speak to the manager."
"No, I don't."
"I'm afraid you must. There is a problem with your bill."
"No, there isn't." Her face turned red. If the locals would get pissed off because I complained about them being late, imagine how they'd feel about being called a liar, whether it was true or not. I tried to step around her, but she intercepted me.
"You must."
I lowered my voice. "You have no idea what kind of man you're protecting." She stepped back, disengaging with the whole situation. The truth was, I had no idea who she was protecting either, but Joao said there was a job here and that was all the motivation I needed. The alley surprised me. The whitewashed buildings meant it was brighter than a summer day in Seattle, but there was very little clutter. It was paved with brick, not the diamond-shaped yellow rocks of the sidewalk. The calzada. Buddy had turned right when he went through the door, but I couldn't see him. I'd wasted too much time with the waitress. The brick alley sloped upward, and there was a short flight of stairs at the far end. Before I did anything else, I sent the photo of Buddy to Annalise. If I caught a bullet in my head, I wanted her to know who put it there. I jogged up the alley toward the stairs. I was armed, but not with a gun. In my back pocket was my ghost knife, the only spell I carried that I had cast myself. It was just a few lines of ink on a small sheet of notepaper, reinforced with mailing tape and laminate, but to me it felt alive, like part of my own body. It could cut ghosts, magic, and dead things, which meant in reverse order that the laminated edge of this sheet of paper could split an I-beam in half, destroy anything with magic in it like a sigil or a predator, and when I used it on the living, it cut their spirits, their souls, and made them as docile as a well-fed baby. It was my only real weapon, and I loved it. But I left it in my pocket. If Buddy knew about me, he might know about my magic. Either he was Joao's friend, or he was Joao's mission. I didn't want to run him off before I either talked to him or murdered him. Besides, I was getting pretty good with my ghost knife, and I was feeling cocky. The alley was narrow, but someone had driven a tiny gray car into it. The fit was so tight, I couldn't see how the driver had gotten out, although the car was empty. The sunroof was open. I hopped onto the hood. The thin metal folded under my weight with the sound at least as loud as my yo. On the far side of the car, the alley sloped downward again, and there was Buddy. He had a woman with him. She had his same surfer complexion and wore her hair in a simple ponytail. And while Buddy's expression was fearful, she narrowed her eyes at me. I had no faith that the windshield would support my weight, so I hopped over the sunroof, landing hard on the tiny trunk. I was trying to avoid an embarrassing fall and barely succeeded. "Hey," I said. "Be cool." Maybe he couldn't understand me, but I hoped my tone and body language would get the message across. The two of them looked sort of harmless, but in this foreign place, I couldn't trust my instincts. "Are you Joao's friends? Joao?" Their expressions made it clear they knew who I was talking about. Buddy's wife laid her hand on her husband's chest and pushed him back. She advanced on me. There was no mistaking that expression. I reached for my ghost knife. The world seemed to slow down. My thoughts raced ahead of what my body could manage, and I urged my arm to move faster. Faster? It wouldn't. At the same time, the alley grew darker and the daylight became reddish. None of the sigils on my chest or arms reacted to it, but this was magic. Buddy seemed to be frozen in place, but his wife was raising her fist toward me. She wasn't holding a gun or a knife. As far as I could tell, she wasn't holding anything, but she didn't have to be. I could feel magic coming off her like sound booming out of an amp. There was no way I could reach my ghost knife before she raised her hand. While I struggled to make my body move, my thoughts raced through the possibilities. Would she throw something? Would she reveal a spell on the palm of her hand? Either way, her skin or the object she was holding would have a sigil inscribed on it, just like my own ghost knife, and it might do anything to me. Set me on fire, put me in a coma, turn me inside out. Anything. I had too much time to think about the hurt that was about to hit me. Still, the muscles in my arm would not move faster, and the ghost knife, which was as much a part of me as my thumb and fingers, lay inert in my pocket even when I tried to call it. There was nothing I could do except watch, and it was my own fault. She spread her fingers with excruciating slowness. There was no enchanted item in her hand and no sigil on her skin. Instead, a pair of lines emerged from her palm like the point of a spear. The lines were reddish silver, and the space between them as pale as ice. The point K kept coming, the lines growing wider and wider until they were no longer coming from her hand but from the air around it. More lines appeared, and the spear point became more complex. It was like a crystal lattice, and as it entered this world, it seemed to press against the air, squeezing it the way a body presses on a mattress. The thing grew larger and larger, warping the space between us. The crystals began to reflect light, multiplying the number of faces I could see in front of me. And there, emerging from the woman's hand, was a faceted structure in the shape of an eye, tinged as red as the day. A predator. It came near me with all the speed of an overfed snail, but my own body was even slower. My muscles were so sluggish it was almost like being frozen in place. The farthest point of the lattice touched my left wrist on the outside, where the spells Annalise had placed on me made my flesh impenetrable. I felt nothing, not even a slight pressure. Then the crystals began to multiply, as though cracking and growing at the same time, as though those were the same things. The angles flashed silver as they appeared, then turned red, wrapping themselves around my wrist. It was engulfing me. It was searching for a way in. I wanted to shout a curse or hit back. I wanted to do anything to stop it. I also wanted Annalise to show up suddenly and save my ass at the last possible moment. None of that happened. The crystals curved around my immobile wrist until they came to unprotected flesh. Then one of the shards pricked my skin, just barely enough to draw blood. That ruby eye rolled backwards like a shark biting down, and the whole elaborate lattice withdrew with a suddenness that shocked me. All I could see of it was a single red drop of my blood on the silvery tip of a crystal, and then it was gone. I could move again. My hand slapped into my back pocket. Before I could draw my ghost knife, I collapsed. My strength was gone. I hit my knees on the bricks, my body still twisting from the leftover momentum of my attempt to draw my weapon. I fell onto my shoulder, my left arm flopping up against my face. My head didn't hit the ground hard, but I fell into unconsciousness anyway. The last thing I saw was a tiny crystalline scar where the predator had stuck me. Before. Secret passageways are cool and all, but we're just passing under the street, right?
Right. Those abandoned apartments you were bitching about are not as abandoned as they look.
No sound penetrated the solid rock above us. I heard no cars passing overhead, nothing. The air was damp and rancid. Secret underground passages are cool as a concept, but being inside one was sort of gross. If this was the way to the first palace, they were clearly not interested in good first impressions. At the far end, Annalise used her thumbprint to open a heavy steel door. On the other side stood a well-dressed woman of about 50. She was tall, lean, and broad-shouldered, with very dark skin and a shaved head. Her left ear was missing a few pieces, and a nasty scar crossed her throat.
"Welcome, Miss Paulis, Mr. Lilly."
She spoke with the same accent that African characters in the movies used, which made me think it was fake.
"So good to see you again, ma'am. Elizabeth apologizes that she could not be here in person."
"But she's on her way."
Annalise didn't sound pleased.
"She is, ma'am."
We entered a room that looked like a lobby for a small, exclusive hotel. A single leather couch rested against one wall, and an unmanned front desk stood opposite. The walls had been painted gold, and a gleaming crystal chandelier hung from the ceiling. But of course, there were no windows. We were underground. There were no bellhops, or no guests, either. The room was clean, but it felt unused. How often did the peers come here, anyway?
"Sorry,"
came a voice from the hall. The woman speaking bustled around the corner into view. She was about 5'10", large-framed without giving an impression of strength. Her curly chestnut hair was rigid with some sort of product, and she'd done up her face like a 40s movie star, with bright red lipstick and mostly pseudo-natural color around her eyes.
"Oh dear, thank you for stepping in, Anita. I'm so sorry. I don't remember a time when we've hosted so many peers at once, and it's not like we can hire temporaries. Hello, Miss Paulis. I apologize for my delay."
"It's fine.
Annalise said. The flat tone of her high, tiny voice suggested that it should not happen again. The woman had a British accent of some kind. It made her sound fancy.
And you must be Mr. Lilly. I'm Elizabeth Treadwell.
She extended her hand and I shook it. Call me Ray.
Excellent, Ray. I'm Elizabeth. Can I take your jacket? And Ms. Powlis?
Despite the summer heat, I'd worn my windbreaker. I'd found it useful over the years, especially for covering up stolen guns stuck into my waistband, but I didn't think I'd need it here. Of course, if I gave it to her, I'd have to ask for it back. I didn't like asking for my own things. Nah.
All right, then.
She seemed surprised by my response, but not offended. With a little clap of her hands, she said,
Well, then, everyone who was planning to come has arrived. They're all waiting.
They had to be the peers, the ageless, barely human sorcerers of the 20 Palace Society I had come to meet. Annalise stepped impatiently toward the hall.
Then let's get this over with.
Elizabeth stepped back, ready to lead me wherever I needed to go, but Anita stopped us all by clearing her throat. I noticed then that Anita and Elizabeth were wearing the same charcoal pinstriped pants suit. Where Anita's was buttoned up, Elizabeth wore hers more loosely, with an open collar and pockets bulging with little devices.
Of course, Elizabeth said. Thank you for reminding me, Anita. Ray, I'm afraid I can't let you into the meeting until you surrender your weapon.
For a moment, I wasn't sure what she meant. I wasn't carrying a gun. They weren't always useful against predators, and I have a bad history with them. Besides, I had just gotten off an airplane. Then I understood what she meant. She wanted my ghost knife. I glanced at Annalise, hoping she would say something like, Fuck that, Ray, you can keep it. She didn't. In fact, she wasn't even looking at me. Her expression was the usual one, impatient and annoyed.
It's standard procedure, Elizabeth said. Nothing personal, I assure you. Anita and I wouldn't be doing our jobs properly otherwise. Never fear, it will be returned promptly.
I drew my ghost knife from my back pocket. I wondered what I could really do with it against a room full of peers, each carrying dozens of spells more powerful than this one. I knew my ghost knife wasn't as destructive as the spells Annalise carried, but it wasn't nothing. If I gave it up, then I'd have nothing. I gave it up. Anita accepted it, wisely holding it between thumb and forefinger to avoid the edges. I could feel it there in her grasp. If I'd called to it, it would have come to me like a faithful pet. But if I had a reason to call for it here in the center of the society's power, I was fucked. Elizabeth said,
Right,
and led us into the hall. The walls were also painted gold, and the carpet looked clean and unused. But the door at the far end was so old it sat warped in the frame.
I'd hoped you would have time to meet the council first, so we could brief you, or debrief you, I guess. But of course the peers don't wait on us, we wait on them. They're here right now, so you're going straight to the top.
How many?
Annalise asked.
5, and we're not sure about Dmitri.
She turned to me.
Dmitri Ilyich Gerasimov is the oldest surviving peer in the society, and he seems to live in Lisbon, although we're not entirely sure where. He simply turns up when things become interesting, but he hasn't appeared today, so who knows?
Still,
Annalise said.
5?
The surprise in her voice made me nervous. We stepped through the door into another lobby, but there were no fancy chandeliers here. Directly in front of us was a pair of elevators. To the left was a heavy double door, and I could hear people moving and talking on the other side. To the right was a short hallway that ended at a room with lots of plastic chairs and a counter with railings on the outside. A cafeteria. As if she could read my mind, Elizabeth said,
After your meeting, perhaps the council could sit down with you over lunch. Sound good?
I nodded. Anita stepped forward and pressed the elevator call button.
I'll have Hayes accompany you.
I'm sure that won't be necessary, Anita,
Elizabeth said.
Thank you.
Anita nodded.
I have duties to attend to.
Then she walked away with my ghost knife. The elevator opened and we stepped on.
She's very conscientious, our Anita, a professional worrier.
She's head of security? Elizabeth nodded.
I hired her myself,
she added, just to make sure I knew how things stood.
Security within the palace is within the purview of peer support, but we'll get into that later.
We got off on the third floor. The windows faced west, but they were cloudy and unwashed. I remembered how the building looked from outside, like it had been abandoned, and wondered if it would give the game away if I stood too close to the glass. On the other side of the hall was a series of heavy wooden doors. Elizabeth led me to a door with a J marked on it, knocked twice, and opened it.
Hello?
She entered first, blocking my view of the room.
Our guest has arrived. Oh dear, should I send up another urn?
Annalise touched my elbow. She gave me a hard look that was too full of meaning to read clearly. Don't let the bastards get you down. Don't fuck up. Don't let anything slip that would get us both killed. Then she moved off down the hall. I followed Elizabeth. Room J looked like it had been modeled on something in an old British mystery show. There was a round oak table in the center of the room with high-backed oak chairs. The oak table had a fancy silver coffee server on a silver tray with thin coffee cups banded with silver. The chair cushions matched the color of the felt on the pool table in the back corner. Light came from delicate table lamps set around the room. The air, like everything else, was stuffy. Before I could turn my attention to the people in the room, one of them said,
We meet again, lively one.
Shit. Callan was here. He sat near me on the right, a crooked grin on his face. I'd half expected to see him here, but I dreaded it, too. We didn't have a friendly history. The society killed people who did the shit I did to him. Beside him was some dude I'd never seen before. He had a narrow face and slicked back hair. I didn't like the way he stared at me. Next around the table was an older guy with bright blue eyes, white hair, and a long, bushy beard. Considering how long peers lived, I figured fashion had come back around to him instead of the other way around. Beside him was Scylla Foldes. I hadn't seen her since she'd murdered someone for no good reason at all. At the moment, she looked almost lucid. Then, finally, I saw the fifth member of the group sitting near me on the left. It was Talcott Arnold Pratt. Holy shit, I blurted out. I thought you were a fucking corpse.
Oh dear,
Elizabeth exclaimed.
Mr. Lilly, we don't use that sort of language with the peers of the society.
Suddenly, I didn't like her anymore. Fine. Hey, Pratt, I thought you were a fucking dead man. Before anyone could scold me further, Scylla held up her hand. Elizabeth closed her mouth and took a step backward. The guy with the slicked back hair spoke up. His voice was low and rough, and his accent was French.
Elizabeth, there is more going on in your department than our meeting, yes? Is it Elias again?
She took a short, cleansing breath.
Mr. Didding finished up another cartel job, and he seems to have acquired an actual truck loaded up with American cash. He's insisting on a charter jet out of Colombia, but I'm working with Issa to arrange a more secure means of transportation.
Don't let us keep you.
Elizabeth could take hints. She left without another glance at me. When the door clicked gently shut behind me, I said,
No, seriously, you were dead.
Pratt smirked.
We're harder to kill than you might think, he said,
with an accent close enough to Elizabeth's that I couldn't pick out any differences.
And if you think I'm grateful for the role you played in reviving me, then you don't understand how all this works.
Oh, right. I forgot that I hated this guy, too.
Do you know why you're here?
Cullen asked. I shrugged. The butterflies in my stomach were in a panic, but I didn't want to show my fear. Scylla had killed a woman with a touch. Pratt woke from the dead. Callan had, at one point, made a building shake with a single stamp of his foot. These people had power. They were ruthless,
and they weren't half as clever as they thought they were. I might have been on their side, but I couldn't be sure they were smart enough to be on mine.
"We've brought you here to the first palace," Pratt said, "to decide whether or not we should kill you."
After.
What the fuck are you doing, Ray? Wake up!
There was no mistaking that voice. I came out of unconsciousness the way a drunk stumbles out of a bar, arms flailing and off balance. I wasn't in the alley anymore. I was in a car. A nice one, too, with leather seats and a sunroof. Audi? My vision was still blurry, so I couldn't be sure, but it felt like an Audi. Arn used to like those. They fetched a good price overseas. Except Annalise was beside me, shaking me awake, and I remembered I wasn't a car thief anymore. Now I killed people.
What the hell, boss? Where am I? How long?
15 minutes, and in the back of Roman's car,
she answered.
Do you remember where you are?
Glancing out the window, I saw white buildings with orange roofs.
Yeah, I remember. Boss, I fucked up. Joao didn't show, but I thought he'd sent someone in his place. When I got close, they turned a predator on me.
I pushed back the sleeve of my jacket to expose my wrist. Where the creature had broken my skin, there was a pale silver piece of crystal slightly smaller than a dime.
Turn the car around,
Annalise said. Roman glanced at us in the mirror. The expression on his lined, mournful face was unreadable. I heard the turn signal switch on.
Sorry, Ray. We don't bring predator magic into the first palace. Not ever.
I didn't have any reason to go to the first palace, so I didn't care about that.
Boss, we gotta get our hands on that couple.
We know who he is,
she answered.
He's been investigated 3 times in the last year and a half, and we haven't found anything against him.
I turned to the driver. Whatever the hell was going on, it must have been big to drag one of the council into the field. Roman, did your people look into his wife? He ran. She fought. The predator was in her.
We will.
With Roman's accent, the words came out, "We will." He ran his thumb over his bushy white eyebrow, then made a call.
Head to their home,
Annalise said. Roman pulled the car into a long parking lot and began to search through his phone.
We need to track down Joao, too, I said. They might have him.
Why? Because he didn't show up when he said he would? Ray, he's Portuguese.
I showed her Joao's text about his friend being in the cafe, then told her about Buddy's panicky phone call and the way he reacted to my face and Joao's name.
Who else knew I'd be there except you and Joao? I think he's in trouble.
Roman spoke up from the front seat.
Which would you like to check out first?
His accent was so thick I needed a moment to understand what he'd said, but Annalise did not.
Send an investigator to Joao's place. Tell them to be careful. Anna and Luis are for us.
Tell them to be careful. I looked down at the little mark on my left wrist. Had it grown a little? It was certainly bigger than when I'd passed out. Anna and Luis were their names? They must have thought I was after them because of the predator, and yet, when I was laid out unconscious in the alley, neither had bothered to kill me. Were they squeamish? I thought again about Anna's expression as she unleashed that predator on me. No way was she squeamish. I looked again at the crystal scar on my wrist. She had worse things in mind. So did my boss. We both knew what happened to people with predators inside them. What had to happen. A laugh tried to come out of me, but I held it in. I'd crossed the U.S. and the Atlantic to tell a bunch of assholes how I'd survived so many jobs, only to be killed like a mook in an alley. I realized Roman was talking, but my head was so full of worries that I hadn't heard him.
8 months ago,
he was saying,
we did our last investigation, 3rd one. That one also turned up little. There were suspicious behaviors like sending their children to his mother's home in Avora, but their neighbor seemed to think they were on the verge of divorce. Luis brings horse home when Anna is away, right to his own house. Anna is often out of town.
When she interrupted, Annalise's voice was tight.
For fuck's sake, Roman! Sex workers are one of the signs you're supposed to be looking for! They're easy targets!
Yes, but the investigator is very thorough here. Every call girl is recorded coming and going. Every girl that enters is allowed to leave.
I thought about the little mark on my wrist, the one that was growing. But a different girl every time, right? Roman scowled.
Yes, that is slightly unusual. Most men have favorites, but the taste for variety...
He turned his palm upward. Annalise's next question suggested she knew what I was thinking.
Did the investigator follow up with any of these women later?
He did not. After 2 months, investigation was closed.
He pulled to the curb.
We are here.
All day I'd seen middle-class people in middle-class clothes coming and going from big, blocky apartment buildings. Boxes within ugly boxes. Anna and Luis were apparently having none of that. They had a single home with a yard on the edge of a winding street with a smooth concrete sidewalk. If not for the obligatory white walls and orange roof, it could have been plucked right out of Coldwater Canyon. After we got out of the car, Roman began going through his messages.
One of our cyber people is assigned to track their phones. Anna and Luis have already purchased tickets for bullet train heading south, probably to Algarve, probably to flee by boat.
When does the train leave? Roman checked his watch.
1 minute from now.
They move fast, I said. We reached the front door. With my ghost knife, I sliced the lock.
Two of our people are in pursuit.
And their bank? I said as I pushed the door in. The house was empty. I could feel it. I stepped inside, ghost knife in hand, just in case. Roman hadn't answered me about the bank. Boss.
Roman, put someone on their bank, she said. Right away, and on their kids, too. If the grandmother buys tickets, I want our people waiting for them at their destination.
Roman took out his phone again. His expression was utterly impassive.
Of course, I will search the cellar.
Ray, take the upstairs.
I went. There were 3 bedrooms. The 2 in the back of the house were decorated for little kids. Sesame Street blankets and toy trains on the floor. And had a thick coat of dust everywhere. If Anna and Luis sent their kids away to keep them safe from her predator, they did it a long time ago. The bathroom had nothing in it but white tile, old cleaning products, and curly hairs on the soap. The main bedroom was a lived-in space. There was no dust on anything, and the 2 bureaus were covered with clutter, mostly bottles of fancy stink for both men and women. It made me wonder if the predators gave them B.O. At the head of the bed was a pair of pillows embroidered with their names. Luis Nunez-Kiel and Anna Helena Nunez-Kiel. They looked new and made me feel like an invader from planet Earth. Me and Annalise spent our time running down people who harbored predators because they were murderous assholes. I wasn't sure how to square that with embroidered fucking pillows with little pink hearts at the corners. The woman who rested her head on that ridiculous pillow had killed me. It didn't matter. I was there to do a job and I got down to it. A lot of regular folks, victims, think the way to hide something is to cover it up. Like they put a box of cash into the bottom of their underwear drawer, hoping a burglar will be all, "Ooh, look at all these unmentionables. Better search someplace else because I'd hate to go through all this private stuff." But really, thieves love private stuff. It feels good to go where you're not wanted. It feels powerful. And it's even more satisfying to fuck those places up. Since Anna was the one who attacked me, I started with her stuff first. I pulled out every drawer, checked the contents, then dumped them onto the floor. I broke the frames of their family photos and tore the pictures out, searching for hidden documents. After that, I opened every box and bottle on her bureau. I made sure the bottles stank like perfume and the boxes had no secret compartments, then dumped the contents onto the clothes. I wasn't wearing gloves because I didn't have to worry about fingerprints. In fact, it was better for me if I did. The twisted path spell that Annalise put onto my torso worked like a very slight shape-changing spell. A day or so after leaving a fingerprint, it wouldn't match me any longer. Same with DNA. As for my face, well, after a couple of weeks, someone who didn't know me well wouldn't recognize me. They were subtle changes, but they were changes. Maybe I was more Raymond Rose than Ray Lilly already. When the inside of the bureau was done, I checked it for spaces that were suspiciously thick, in case the keels had a hidey hole there. Then I smashed the mirror, searching it the same way I'd searched the pictures. Finally, I yanked the bureau away from the wall, dumping it over everything else. I searched for a long time and didn't find anything more useful than a Bic pen. Luis's shit got the same treatment with slightly better results. The wooden backing of his mirror had split from the glass, and he'd slid a manila folder into it. For a moment, I thought I'd hit the jackpot, but instead of deeds to mountain cabins, waterfront bungalows, or other hiding spots, it contained a list of women's names and phone numbers. I frisbeed it into the hall where it would be clear of the mess I was making, and went to work on the closet. Checking the pocket of every coat and shirt, then the insides of their shoes, then the miscellaneous bullshit that collects in out-of-the-way places of people's homes. Then I flipped the mattresses and tore apart the bedside lamps and end tables. I cut the pillows and mattresses open. In the end, the only thing I came away with was that envelope full of names, a box of jewelry, and a stack of euros, mostly hundreds, that added up to 10 grand. The envelope was for Roman. The jewelry got tossed back into the mess. The cash went into my pocket. The keels put a predator in me. I figured they owed me. I went downstairs. Annalise had torn the kitchen apart. There's nothing quite like the aftermath of a really good search. People say it looks like a hurricane went through or a bomb went off, but it's just not the same. Thieves make this shit personal. The boss had already moved into the living room, tearing the leather couch apart as easily as I'd peel a banana. She was just about done. Roman came out of the basement.
"Nothing below,"
he said. I handed him the envelope. Then, on impulse, I went downstairs. The basement was a small room, no larger than the kitchen above it. Roman had yanked the tools off a pegboard and thrown them at the foot of a shelving unit. There were open cardboard boxes and rusty bike parts strewn around. The air smelled faintly of chemicals. A plastic Christmas tree stood alone in a corner, cobwebs on its branches. I stood there for a while, looking around. Something was wrong here, but I wasn't sure what it was. I looked at every detail, listened for odd sounds, but nothing came to me. After a short while, Annalise came down the stairs.
"What are you doing, Ray? There's nothing here, and the fire is ready to go."
Annalise liked to burn down buildings just in case she missed some asshole's spellbooks. "Boss, doesn't this room seem too small?" She looked at me, then laid her hand on the wall beside the stairs. It was plaster over stone. The other three were particle board. She punched through one, then a second. There was nothing behind the second wall but empty space. A moment later, she had kicked through the wall into the darkness beyond. I ducked down and followed her in. It was dark, and the air stank like a leaking freezer. I found a light switch and flipped it on, then realized I was standing beside a door. I tried to open it, but got no joy. The other side was blocked by the shelving unit, where Roman had thrown the tools.
"Here we go,"
Annalise said. She was standing in front of a large freezer unit that was running so quietly I could barely hear the pumps, even from a few feet away. The red light above the door was on, and I could feel cold coming off it in waves. It looked like a brushed steel tomb, 10 feet tall and a dozen wide and long. I pulled the latch. A light switched on inside, illuminating a narrow bed and a squarish composting toilet. The bed sheets were silk, as was the pillowcase. There was a top sheet, but no blanket, no comforter, no quilt. No embroidered pillows, either. Annalise stepped into the doorway.
"It's set for -16 degrees. That's Celsius, obviously. What do you think?"
Her words seemed to come from far away. The mark on my wrist ached, and the cold washed over my skin like soothing music. It promised dreamless sleep, the deepest, most perfect rest anyone has ever had. I swayed on my feet, almost stumbling inside and falling onto that bed. Instead, I wrenched myself away. Annalise slammed the door shut, and the urge to dive into the unconsciousness passed.
The predator wanted the cold, I said, my voice shaking like a junkie about to fall off the wagon. It wanted that room.
It's growing,
Annalise said, frowning at my wrist.
In a few hours, I might not have been able to resist.
Annalise nodded toward something beside me. There was a long metal table in the corner. It looked like something a medical examiner would use to cut up a body, and as soon as the thought entered my mind, I noticed the sluice, drain pipe, and oversized bucket. Mounted on the wall by the end of the table was a magnetic rack filled with restaurant-quality cutlery. Even from here, I could see that nothing had been cleaned properly. Was the freezer for Anna or her victims? I didn't know, and I hoped to never find out. With any luck, she would be dead very, very soon, and I would get to kill her. Roman's voice echoed down the stairs. The Keels had been spotted leaving their bank in downtown Lisbon. I looked around.
Burn this place to ash.
Before. There was only one thing to say to that.
Fuck you.
I turned my back on them, goosebumps running all the way up to my scalp, and headed to the door. It was only 5 strides to the hall, but they were the longest moments of my life. None of the peers drilled a lightning bolt into the back of my head or set me on fire or turned me into dust. They could have done it, or something like it, but they didn't. Then I was out the door. Annalise was gone. I walked to the elevator and rode down, back down to the lobby. Time to eat. I wasn't really hungry, but it was early enough for a cup of coffee. Besides, I'd skipped the most important meal of the day. If the assholes in the society planned to kill me, I was going to squeeze a meal out of them first. I went into the cafeteria and got myself a tray. Elderly women scooped food onto my plate. Switch out the old women for old men, and I could have been back in prison. Except not really, because this was the nicest cafeteria I'd ever seen. Everything was clean and the formed plastic furniture was comfortable, like a brand new McDonald's. It's also possible that I don't eat in nice places. I carried a wedge of scrambled eggs, a plump red sausage, a little brown roll, and what looked like a tiny pie, barely larger than a quarter at its base, to a little table in the corner. Only the little roll was actually good, although the eggs were okay. I ate it all, though. Because of the spells Annalise had put on me, I needed to eat meat to survive.
May I join you?
It was Callan. He stood over my little table with a crooked smile on his face, as though asking permission for anything was his little joke. A few of the other peers were in the buffet line. I shrugged.
If it's going to be a crowd, we should move to a bigger table.
Callan glanced at the ceiling, then turned toward the large table in the center of the room. It was then that I realized the room had fallen silent. Every face was turned toward him. The little crowd at the center table jumped up and moved away as though it had caught fire. I sat. Callan sat opposite, drinking his tiny cup of coffee. They didn't offer regular coffee, just little shots of espresso. I hadn't touched mine. Shots of espresso were a white-collar thing, and I wasn't a white-collar guy.
Scylla Foldes was the only one who didn't join us. Maybe her lucid moment was up. When they'd all gathered, I said,
"So, are we going to play a bunch of bullshit games, or are we going to have a real conversation?"
"You understand, I hope,"
said the man with the slicked back hair,
"that we could kill you at any point, easily."
I tried my tiny pie. It was nasty.
"Yeah, but saying it makes you look weak."
He bared his teeth at me. Callan tilted his head back and laughed. The dude with the beard spoke up. His accent was different from the others, but I'm not good with accents.
"He's right, Alexander. Stop threatening our employees."
He turned toward me.
"Callan said you would not respond well to assertive talk."
Assertive. These guys tell me they're thinking of killing me, and he calls it assertive. Callan cut a slice of his sausage, sniffed it, and dropped it onto his plate.
What have you been told about the reasons we have called you here?
That Annalise and me are having some success, and that I'm a wooden man who keeps surviving jobs that should get me killed. Wooden man was my role in the society. It meant that I was supposed to be a distraction while my peer staged the real attack. It wasn't a job that came with a retirement plan. You want to know how, so you can duplicate it.
No,
Alexander said, smirking.
We are wondering why you and Mrs. Paulus are going on so many missions while the rest of us have nothing to do.
What the hell? What's that supposed to mean? They were all studying my expression with skeptical little smiles on their faces.
It means that our war is nearly won, Pratt said. After more centuries than you or I could count, summoning spells are going out of the world.
He looked like he meant it. He was too full of himself to bullshit someone like me, a guy he thought was a nobody. How are you winning anything? I asked. The society hunts down spells and destroys them, but people go online now. Some asshole could take a picture of a spell, post it, and 50,000 people could download a copy. A million.
Except we're ahead of them, Pratt said, still smirking. We've been ahead of them for decades. We hire the best people and we pay them a fortune to put us in the place the rogues want to be before they can get there. When someone posts a spell online, even in the secret places, we're already there waiting for them. The dangerous ones are the ones who don't go online.
They're the careful ones,
Callan said.
Older, like us.
I looked at their faces. They looked like average assholes. Pratt looked about 35 years old, while Callan and the dude with the beard looked mid-50s, with Alexander somewhere in the middle. Except I knew each had lived a century or two at least.
The younger, sloppier ones, Pratt continued, were dealt with 10 or 12 years ago. Everyone started going online, but we anticipated that. When the internet was just 3 machines chirping over a phone line, we had our people in place. We had a few busy years, but it's paid off. Things have been quieter than any of us can remember.
Okay. What else could I say? I heard you were losing the war. Pratt spread his hands, still smirking.
Do I look like a man who is losing a war?
I decided not to tell Pratt what he looked like. But you have a peer working against the cartels?
The drug cartels,
Callan corrected, which I guess meant there were other kinds too.
Organized crime has always been a concern for us, in part because they seek power wherever they can find it, and in part because governments want to tear them apart and uncover their secrets. The society would prefer that spells fall into the hands of drug-dealing psychopaths than government functionaries, for a number of reasons.
Aside from the cartels,
Alexander put in,
there is very little activity, except for Annalise and you.
Callan spread his palms.
We need to know if the reports that Annalise sends us are accurate.
I don't read them.
Tell us then about the missions, in your own words.
They wanted me to inform on Annalise. They thought like cops, and I was supposed to be their snitch. My first instinct was to tell them to fuck off again, but I knew it would be the wrong move. They'd come at me pretty hard in Room J, and they knew it. Now they were being reasonable, for peers of the 20 Palace Society at least, and they wouldn't be warned off again. I tore off a hunk of bread and chewed it slowly. The one with the beard did the same. I wondered if he was mirroring me to try and build trust between us, but he didn't look that clever. The thing was, Annalise was one of them. Unequal peers, Callan had called her once, years ago, before I ripped him off and tricked my boss into attacking him. Unequal, maybe, but still a peer of the society. She didn't have their raw power, but she was just like them, except she was out in the world doing shit while they lounged around. So I had two questions in front of me. Did I think Annalise would send faked reports to the society? Fuck no. Her mission was to save the world, and she took that shit seriously. Second, would she want me to tell them what we'd done? Alexander smirked at me.
Your hesitation is answer enough.
Bullshit, I said. You're asking me to snitch. I'm pretty sure the boss wouldn't mind, but...
But you are a criminal,
Callan said.
With a criminal's habits.
I shrugged. Then I told them about the jobs I'd done with Annalise. Seattle, Hammer Bay, Los Angeles, Washaway, even the little one from last week outside Vegas. I didn't go into any depth, just gave them the basics. Where we were, who we had to kill, what sort of predator we faced. I left out the innocent bystanders who'd been killed because we didn't have all day, and I knew they didn't care. They were looking at me funny when I finished.
Well,
Callan said, sitting back.
Does anyone doubt him?
Alexander scowled at me.
I'm not sure,
he said, because he still didn't want to believe me.
Enough,
the guy with the beard said.
He has been more open with us than we are with each other, and Miss Paulus has ever been a dedicated colleague. Whatever is happening, the simplest explanation is not the correct one.
They all sat back.
If Annalise's reports are correct,
Callan said,
then it appears that you have been instrumental in her success in a way that no other wooden man has ever been. During our busy years, we tried to make use of auxiliary agents, trained military operatives, big game hunters, professional bounty hunters, but most didn't survive a single mission, let alone five.
He seemed to be waiting for me to say something. When he didn't, he folded his hands on the table.
Raymond Milman Lilly, who are you?
I had no idea how to answer. After. We had no hope of picking up the keels at their bank, and I was glad. Banks weren't the best place to have a showdown of any kind, especially not a supernatural one. Instead, Roman told me he was taking us to a place with a name I couldn't pronounce or remember, and that one of his people would meet us there with tickets. The airport? I didn't like that idea either. Better to throw down in a secure building with multiple security systems than a thin aluminum tube at 20,000 feet. But I was wrong. The tickets that were waiting for us were for a train. Because Europe, I guess. Roman dropped us off and pulled away, heading back to the first palace. We were met by an elderly woman with a crooked back and a sly expression. She carried the biggest handbag I'd ever seen. She looked us over.
I've never met Pierce before. Are you Pierce?
No.
Yes.
She nodded.
Well, then, let's hurry.
The train station was all poured concrete arches underneath and high, fancy lattice on the upper platform where we were supposed to catch the train. I would have gotten lost at least once, trying to follow the signs, but the older woman led us straight to the platform we needed just as our train pulled in. It was red and white, with a fancy blue interior. Our seat numbers weren't consecutive, but they were together, somehow.
Call me Maria,
the woman with the sly expression said. She nodded toward Annalise's oversized firefighter jacket.
Madam, your appearance would attract too much attention, but the young man and I should move closer. Our targets have tickets all the way to Braga in the north, but they will almost certainly get off early, probably in Oporto.
I shook my head. They've already seen me.
Too bad,
she said, laying a hand on my arm.
I like a handsome young man who can save me from being eaten. If they gather their things early, I will notify Mr. Marchuk.
No,
Annalise said.
For this, you'll be talking directly to me. I will decide what to pass on to the council. If Roman has an objection to that, he can make it to me.
The last sentence cut off whatever Maria was about to say. They exchanged phone numbers, and the older woman hobbled toward the car in the front. Annalise and I sat in silence as the train pulled out of the station. A little reader board above the exit showed our speed, and I was astonished at the way the numbers climbed until I realized it was kilometers per hour, not miles per hour. I took out my phone to convert them and was still impressed. Then I had an idea to spend the next 20 minutes fumbling with my phone and the translation program in it.
Did you know that Roman has his own Wikipedia page?
Annalise didn't seem impressed. Not in English, obviously, but my phone can translate stuff now. Sort of. His first big case was a kidnapping. A Russian oligarch's daughter. He tracked them down, slipped into the house at night, and walked out with her. Just like that. After that, he broke up a smuggling ring selling guns overseas, helped seize a few drug shipments, and survived 2 assassination attempts. The translation is a little confusing, but I think one was by other cops.
What's your point, Ray?
He's an effective cop who broke big cases but got demoted a few times, too. He's never going to be a big shot. Probably terrible at politics. Probably not corrupt enough. He's too effective to fire, but certain elements would be okay with him becoming a martyr. Right? So does that seem like the Roman we spent the morning with?
People will surprise you, Ray. No one who meets you realizes that you're the guy you are.
I had nothing to say to that, once I'd figured out what she meant. I glanced down at the mark on my wrist. It had grown past the size of a dime, much larger than the pinprick that had put me down for the count. It was a pretty emerald green color now, and it looked like a piece of crystal, as though someone had glued costume jewelry over my pulse. Then I did the thing I'd been resisting since I woke up in the back of Roman's car. I touched it. It wobbled like jelly. My stomach did a flip-flop. I'd expected it to be as hard as glass, but this was alive, like a jellyfish with facets. And my body had started to react to it. The skin around the mark was swollen and red. I was fighting an infection no antibiotic could cure. Of course, I had my ghost knife in my back pocket. I could feel it there, and I had used it to kill predators in the past. But that was unpredictable. If I didn't kill the thing with the first cut, it might jump to someone else, or set me on fire, or fly apart in a million spores, or do anything. And while the infection might have looked like a spot on my arm, the sort of thing that could be managed with a machete, it was already inside every part of me. It was already in my head. Nothing else could explain how I'd felt at the threshold of that freezer. I'd practically swooned like a schoolgirl at her first boy band concert. And for what? A killing cold.
How do you want it?
Annalise asked. She was looking at my wrist, too.
Did you bring your vest?
She nodded. Her firefighter's coat, which she wore on missions because, while she was bullet and fireproof, her clothes weren't, was fastened shut. Underneath, I knew she had a vest covered with little colored ribbons. Some were green, some were white. Rainbows didn't have as many colors. An alligator clip held one end of each ribbon to the vest. The other end had a little sigil drawn there. That collection was the main weapon in her arsenal, if you didn't count her ruthless will and terrifying strength.
Okay. I didn't even have to think about it. The green fire.
She absent-mindedly touched her abdomen where the green ribbons were kept.
Are you sure? There are less painful ways.
I thought briefly of all the pain Annalise had given me over the years. This thing loves the cold, so fire should be our first choice. Actually, our second. I meant to say more, but the words wouldn't come. Just for a moment. She waited.
How about this? I said, after I'd run through the possibilities. When it's time, I'll destroy my iron gate. Just cut through it. Then I'll try the ghost knife on this thing. I gestured vaguely toward my wrist.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.